Steven Hayden Pollock was born on August 12, 1947, in Los Angeles, California. Pollock attended the University of Wisconsin, where he completed his undergraduate studies and met his girlfriend, Linda Deer. The two fell in love with not just each other, but also shared their love of mushrooms together. Eventually, Pollock ended up at the Medical College of Wisconsin, where he completed his medical degree. After graduating med school in 1975, Pollock moved to Texas and soon got a job, netting himself a position in the pharmacology department at UT Health San Antonio. While doing run-of-the-mill medical research at UT, Pollock dedicated all of his free time to mycology and mushroom-related pursuits, specifically the psychoactive mushroom species that contained psilocybin. This was the one subject that he was truly passionate about, with Pollock becoming rapidly obsessed with the fungi, as well as the psychedelic indoles, psilocybin and psilocin, contained within them. Earlier in 1974, while still in med school, Pollock traveled to Hawaii and was the first person to collect specimens of the species, which would later be described by Roger Heim as Copelandia cyanescens, now called Paniolus cyanescens. In 1975, the now doctor authored his famous article, The Psilocybin Mushroom Pandemic, which was published in the Journal of Psychedelic Drugs. That year, during the fall of 1975, Pollock, along with Jonathan Ott, collected psychoactive species in Washington State and British Columbia, Canada, which were identified with the help of Gaston Guzman. Guzman enlisted the help of Pollock and Ott while working on his psilocybe monograph. 1976 would see Pollock writing another article for the Journal of Psychedelic Drugs, titled Psilocybian Mycetismus with Special Reference to Paniolus, followed by Liberty Caps Recreational Hallucinogenic Mushrooms at the end of the year for Drug and Alcohol Dependence. Also in 1976, Pollock would attend the first international conference on hallucinogenic mushrooms with Linda, where this photograph was taken. Pollock felt that psilocybin had great medical and therapeutic potential, and he sought to conduct research on the subject, hoping to obtain evidence that would prove their benefit to the medical establishment. Painting the exterior of his Winnebago chieftain camper that he owned in wild and colorful psychedelic patterns, Pollock converted the interior of the RV, turning it into a mobile microbiology laboratory. Pollock outfitted the camper with an autoclave, numerous petri dishes, desiccators, and all the necessary tools to culture the psilocybin mushrooms that Pollock wanted to research. This begs the question, was Vince Gilligan, creator of Breaking Bad, aware of Pollock's story about his RV, and did it inspire his series? At his home on Springbrook Avenue in San Antonio, which also served as both the mushroom laboratory and the office of his medical practice, Pollock used his home kitchen to culture psilocybin mushroom species whenever he wasn't at work at the UT Pharmacology Unit. This occurred all while he was finishing his residency in anesthesiology and wrote grant proposals to get funding for studies related to areas of research, including studying the metabolism of opioids in the liver, along with other similar medical subjects, which did not interest Pollock as much as his mushroom research. Pollock's goal was to be able to conduct his independent mushroom research full-time. Eventually, he would do so, financing his research with the money he made as a physician during the day, along with the profits from a popular mushroom distribution business he would soon create, selling mushroom growing kits and spores of psilocybin species by mail, with the company's base of operations being right there in San Antonio. In his off time, Pollock devised new experimental methods of mushroom cultivation, utilizing unorthodox growing mediums for the mushrooms, which included using dog food, specifically Purina dog chow, which contains no artificial preservatives, with the brand priding itself on being all natural, being chock full of rice, wheat, corn, and other grain, providing an excellent nutrient medium for the mushrooms, as well as a gamut of other materials, which saw Pollock experimenting with using different types of grass, including Timothy and Johnson grass, with the doctor also attempting to use clover, alfalfa, rye, brown rice, soybeans, oats, corn, cannabis seeds, and coffee grounds, as well as both parakeet and canary seed, among others over the course of his mushroom-growing experimentation. Pollock's methods included novel substrates comprising of manure coming from several different types of animal species. Rather than just using cow manure, Pollock experimented with using manure from a mix of exotic animals, ranging from sheep manure to manure coming from horses and even elephants. Pollock kept a collection of various animal manures at his home, always getting fresh samples delivered to his door by the pickup truck load. The manure would be placed in trash bags and heat sterilized in the doctor's own kitchen to be later used for growing mushrooms. In 1977, Pollock published the techniques he devised through trial and error with his many experiments growing mushrooms, putting all that he learned into a book he authored, Magic Mushroom Cultivation. Pollock wrote the book with the hope that he could teach anyone the simple process of how to grow mushrooms, even if they had no experience in a microbiology lab previously. The book featured the use of brown rice in the mushroom's substrate, often referred to as the brown rice tech. The use of brown rice flour would be utilized decades later by Psilocybe fanaticus and his incredibly popular and easy-to-follow PF Tech. In recent years, evidence from research on brown rice has demonstrated that its use as a growth medium increased levels of psilocybin in the fruiting bodies grown from it, compared to mushrooms which were not grown with brown rice, further vindicating early researchers such as Pollock. Pollock released the book under his Herbal Medicine Research Foundation, and the book became one of the first home-growing psilocybin mushroom guides, occurring just 1 year after Terence and Dennis McKenna published Psilocybin, Magic Mushroom Grower's Guide, with the brothers using the pseudonyms O.T. Oss and O.N. O'Eric. Their book jump-started the magic mushroom growing revolution, introducing many to the topic for the first time, and allowing people all over the world to grow psychoactive mushrooms from home without the need of costly equipment or supplies. The book by the McKenna brothers was inspired by a series of peculiar experiences with the mushrooms while the two were on an expedition in the Amazon jungle, initially in search of a plant they had only heard about called yahe, now better known as ayahuasca. Traveling in search for the psychedelic in 1971, deep in the Putumayo River Basin in Colombia, the brothers instead encountered an abundance of psilocybin-containing mushrooms growing all around them. The McKennas, recognizing the mushrooms to be the psilocybin species first introduced to Western science by R. Gordon Wasson, but neither brother having any experience with the mushroom up until that point, sought to consume them. Terence and Dennis relished at the opportunity to try the psychoactive fungi. The brothers began eating the mushrooms and got their first taste of the psilocin-induced experience. With their food supply running low, Terence and Dennis simply started eating more of the mushroom for sustenance, as well as for its entheogenic effect, as mushrooms were plentiful in their environment. Adding the mushrooms to their meals, with the pair throwing them into soups, eventually it happened that the psilocybin species comprised almost the entirety of their diet while there in the Amazon. Consuming the fungi practically non-stop and stepping foot into the psilocybin experience for not only hours, but days, Terence and Dennis had some very remarkable and even unexplainable experiences, some of which verged on the supernatural. Terence has told the story of eating the mushrooms and encountering an entity contained within the fungi, which Terence often referred to as the mushroom. Giving the men what seemed like a profound knowledge while they were consuming the fungi, the mushroom communicated to the brothers that it wanted them to go forth and spread its knowledge to anyone that they could. Thus, the brothers publish Psilocybin, Magic Mushroom Grower's Guide, as well as another book called The Invisible Landscape, Time, Hallucinogens, and the I Ching, which contained eccentric theories informed by knowledge that the mushroom bestowed upon the men, and the brothers attempting to explain their experiences in the context of science. Some of these ideas bestowed upon the men via the mushroom include a theory that human memory is contained within the DNA of cells, and also serve as a basis for Terence's novelty theory in Time Wave Zero software, using the Mayan calendar and an ancient Chinese divinatory text, the I Ching, as its foundation. Not only could the software chart levels of novelty at dates in the past, but it even predicted the novelty of future dates, with an anomaly scheduled to occur on December 21st, 2012, coinciding with the end of the Mayan calendar. Terence was not sure what was going to happen at that point, which Terence's theory called the zero point, though he often referred to the event as the transcendental object at the end of time, and over the course of his life, he speculated as to what it might bring. Terence continued pursuing his novelty theory for the rest of his life, as well as the respect he had for the mushroom who taught him the information, with Terence often being quoted as saying that he was PR man for the mushroom. Unfortunately, Terence did not get to see the mysterious zero date that his theory predicted, as he died in 2000 after a battle with brain cancer. His younger brother, Dennis, survived him. Although Dennis has spent his career focused on the more rigorous scientific research into psychedelics, founding the Hefter Research Institute, named after the man responsible for beginning the study of psychedelics when he successfully identified the active chemical in the peyote cactus, which he named mescaline, with Hefter taking the hydrochloride salt of the compound and testing it on himself, verifying that it was indeed responsible for the cactus's visionary effect. Dennis's work, which had him investigating the chemistry and psychopharmacology of psychedelics for decades, continues to this day, with Dennis doing research that is not all that different from what Pollock was after with psilocybin in the 70s. Though unlike Pollock, McKenna's research has always fallen under the confines of the law. While in the Amazon, Terence had encountered a species of mushroom that was larger and taller than anything he had seen before. He collected spores of the mushroom, sending them to his friend Steven Pollock in Texas, with the label Amazonian, which Pollock attempted to culture. Seeing the sheer length and size of the phallic mushrooms that grew when he attempted to cultivate Terence's Amazonian spores, Pollock came up with the idea to genetically alter the mushroom and get it as close as he could to a real human penis, resulting in the strain of Psilocybe cubensis, which would eventually become known as penis envy. In 1977, Pollock traveled to Tampa, Florida, in order to attend the Second International Mycological Congress, an event that would serve as being one of the most significant moments in the doctor's life, dictating the future of his career in the world of mushrooms. Pollock was interested in listening to a speech given by famed Mexican psychedelic figure, Gaston Guzman, known for his monograph, The Genus Psilocybe, a systematic revision of the known species, including the history, distribution, and chemistry of the hallucinogenic species. It was a definitive text dedicated to outlining the active species that reside in the most common genus of psilocybin mushrooms. Another attendee at the conference who was excited to hear the 45-minute lecture was Gary Linkoff, author of the National Audubon Society Field Guide to North American Mushrooms. While Pollock was standing outside the convention, sorting mushrooms in front of his Winnebago, Linkoff went over to the long-haired, bearded physician and asked him the name of the species he had in his collection there. Pollock informed him that they were a psilocybin species that he discovered in the parking lot of the convention, and soon invited Linkoff inside his Winnebago mushroom lab to have a closer look. Walking into the camper, Linkoff saw Pollock's well-equipped lab and saw several copies of his first book, Magic Mushroom Cultivation, which was published that same year. Besides their shared love of Gaston Guzman, Linkoff was a fellow hippie with a scruffy appearance and long beard, but most importantly, he was, like Pollock, similarly mushroom-obsessed. The two kindred spirits hit it off immediately. Pollock, who found the conference itself to be a bore for the most part, eventually asked Linkoff if he wanted to go mushroom hunting with him, as well as, according to Alan Rockefeller, an invitation to go smoke marijuana, with the two traveling to an area with farms just outside the city of Tampa, where Pollock sought to find Paniola species. Approaching one spot, they first asked a farmer for permission to search his fields and cow pastures, showing him the badges each of the men received while they were attending the mycological conference. There in the cow pasture, Pollock sat looking for mushrooms, with Linkoff weary of entering and joining the doctor, lest they be trampled by the herd of cows amongst them. While hunting, Pollock saw a brown-hued mushroom specimen, whose gills were a deep purple color, which communicated its psychoactivity and presence of indole psychedelics. The mushroom immediately caught Pollock's attention. It being a species that he could not identify, Pollock took the mushroom back to his lab in the Winnebago and began to examine the new mushroom he had just discovered, bisecting the fungus with a scalpel and excising a small amount of tissue from the stem, with the intent of culturing the mushroom on agar. When Pollock finally left Tampa to go back home to San Antonio, he took the new species with him, attempting to grow the mushroom in his Winnebago. Once he got home, he saw that mycelium had quickly spread on the growth medium, with the mushrooms showing the reassuring signs of steady growth. There in the mycelium web, Pollock observed two brown spherical objects, observing that they bruised blue, a good sign that they contained psilocybin. Once the spherical growths, called a sclerotium, matured, Pollock harvested them and threw them in his mouth. In performing the bioassay, Pollock determined that the sclerotia were indeed active, just like their mushroom mother. The mushroom produced a sclerotium similar to the infamous fungus ergot, Claviceps purpurea, which grows on wheat and contains LSA, the precursor which serves as a starting point in the synthesis of LSD. Pollock christened the sclerotium he had just discovered the cosmic camote, sometimes even giving it the pet name Camotillo. He also called it the philosopher's stone, as it was unlike anything he'd previously experienced. Pollock named the new mushroom species Psilocybe tampinensis, named after Tampa, Florida, where it was discovered. Pollock spent a great deal of time then breeding tampinensis and isolated a strain from the mushroom which Pollock attempted to patent in July of 1979. According to Gary Linkoff, Pollock was growing camote sclerotium so large that they grew to the size of ostrich eggs. Inspired by his experiences with the camote and wanting to spread it, Pollock believed that psilocybin, and more specifically, the sclerotium he called the cosmic camote, held immense therapeutic and medicinal value. Needing to prove its efficacy, he wanted to devise studies that would show the results of the mushroom and sclerotia proving that they had great benefit to modern science. In March of 1979, Pollock created the San Antonio-based Texas mushroom supply business, Hidden Creek. He would run with his business partner, Michael Forbes. Hidden Creek shipped several varieties that Pollock had discovered, including his precious Psilocybe tampinensis sclerotium. Pollock and Forbes, in an attempt to advertise their new company, bought ads in High Times, which featured full-page advertisements that showcased Pollock's mushrooms with a brief description of each species or strain. By 1980, Hidden Creek had become the largest mushroom distributor in the world. It seems that Pollock owned another company called the Perpetual Gardens, which sold liquid mushroom cultures. Pollock wanted to try to get a DEA license permitting him to work with psilocybin in an official context as a researcher, rather than his research up until that point, which had been illegal. He also sought FDA-approved clinical trials of psilocybin, with the testing of his cosmic camote being the number one priority. Pollock hoped that one day he would be able to prescribe psilocybin mushrooms to his patients as an FDA-approved legitimate pharmaceutical, serving as an alternative to traditional prescription medication, but also which had an effect on the mood and personality of the person consuming it. Pollock needed to show that the psilocybin species had a noticeable medicinal effect, hopefully providing sufficient evidence proving itself capable of treating a variety of ailments. The results of these studies, Pollock hoped, would vindicate him, definitively proving that the mushroom species and sclerotia were important and effective medicines that needed to be investigated by science. Needing to demonstrate that tampinensis worked on an established medical disorder, Pollock chose to work with autism. For the study, Pollock used children with autism that belonged to his patients, giving the camote to two or three children in order to see if tampinensis demonstrated any noticeable improvement in the children. The results of the autism study showed that the children saw a great improvement after eating Pollock's camote, although the effect was found to be only temporary. After the failed attempt by Pollock in applying for the patent on his tampinensis strain, Pollock then had the idea to finance a large-scale laboratory dedicated to his mushroom research. Once obtaining his DEA license and being granted legal authority to work and do research with psilocybin, Pollock would quit his job as a physician and research into the fungi full-time. Pollock's business partner, Michael Forbes, however, believes that Pollock never actually gave any psychoactive mushroom or sclerotia species to children, but instead made up the story in an effort to appeal to the DEA so that they might approve his psilocybin studies, and Pollock could continue his research, now legitimately, for the first time, and adhering to the confines of the law. Pollock began sketching out plans to begin the construction of his massive mushroom laboratory, deciding to build it on several hundred acres of ranch land. The cost of building Pollock's laboratory would require a great deal of financing, which Pollock did not have. To help raise funds for the lab, Pollock started selling as many mushroom spore kits as Hidden Creek could ship out, and taking numerous ads out in magazines which catered to the counterculture and whose readers would be interested in buying mushroom kits and spores from Hidden Creek. In his private practice, Pollock also began writing an increased number of prescriptions to his patients. All of the income Pollock obtained through his practice and Hidden Creek went straight to his mushroom research and dream to build his lab. Pollock also increased the size of his home laboratory that his mushroom research now required. In order to seek out psilocybin mushroom species outside the U.S., Pollock frequently traveled to Mexico, Brazil, and the Amazon rainforest, with the intent on studying the local mushroom flora of each place he visited, focused on charting the geographic distribution of the mushrooms. Pollock discovered three novel active psilocybe species in 1979, Psilocybe armandii, Psilocybe wassoniorum, and Psilocybe schultzii, species that were completely new to the world of science. Pollock authored many scientific papers in the late 70s. On two separate occasions, while Pollock was abroad looking for mushrooms in various exotic locales, his San Antonio home was burglarized. After getting his house broken into for the second time, Pollock purchased large steel doors, as well as grates to put over his windows, which would be installed in his home to prevent any more theft, and most importantly, to keep his precious mushroom species safe. Pollock, going against the recommendation that he buy a gun for protection, enlisted the help of his friend, fellow mycophile mushroom researcher, Paul Stamets. Stamets was to teach Pollock Hua Ring Do, a method of martial arts originating from Korea. Hidden Creek was nestled between articles written by the then-frequent High Times contributor, Andrew Weil, who has made a name for himself in recent years as a medical doctor in support of natural medicines, becoming something of a celebrity doctor and authoritative guru on all things dealing with natural healing. Weil is also known for the several books he's authored, as well as popularizing the idea of the anti-inflammatory diet, something which Weil claims would improve the health of anyone that follows its dietary restrictions, lessening the chance of contracting various illnesses and diseases through the anti-inflammatory action of the foods in the diet. Weil can be seen with his bearded, white-haired appearance, graced on the cover of magazines sold at the front of grocery stores at the checkout, with his magazines being sold at health food and natural shops such as Sprouts Farmers Market. A small feud erupted between Weil and Pollock, with the two doctors arguing with each other in the Journal of Psychedelic Drugs. Weil called out Pollock and attempted to disprove Pollock's claim that Panaeolus subalteatus induced dysphoria, and Weil being quoted as saying that the mushroom was a superb psychotropogen, as he put it. The two men can be seen in this photo seated beside each other on a couch. Despite the two men's public disagreements in the world of psychoactive fungi, Pollock claimed that he and Weil still got along privately, although Weil, by contrast, was quoted as saying that he never felt much of an affinity for him, and then added the fact that Pollock's appearance didn't look very presentable. The Harvard-trained Weil, while bearded, has a somewhat more conservative look now, but in the 1970s, Weil certainly had a hippie-esque appearance, not all that dissimilar to Pollock. In 1980, a year in which the DEA attempted to make prescription drugs like Quaaludes and Preludin illegal, Pollock continued to write out prescriptions for his patients in large numbers and as quickly as he could write them. Pollock still wrote prescriptions for a variety of drugs, including Enderits, Quaaludes, Gyrocaps, Chronotabs, Gratimits, Spansules, Dilaudid, and Disoxin, among others. The State Pharmacy Board in Texas even scheduled an entire special seminar that was focused on Pollock and his unethical practices as a licensed physician. There is a claim that, due to his increased prescription writing and influx of new patients looking for an easy way to get prescribed any drug they wanted, Pollock even purchased his own pharmacy in order to keep up with his patients' demand for prescription drugs. with the line to enter his home office becoming so large that they began spilling out into the front lawn of his home. According to his former Hidden Creek business partner, Michael Forbes, Pollock's lists of patients looking to get their fix spanned a wide gamut, ranging from scientists and government officials, right alongside the junkies, as Forbes points out. Pollock's unethical practices as a physician came to the great displeasure of his Hidden Creek associates, who feared that criminal or seedy connections would harm their otherwise quasi-legal mushroom business. A man whose identity is not known, however, claimed that the DEA was very close to shutting down Hidden Creek anyway. At the height of the late doctor's drug pushing, Pollock is said to have made as much as $2 million, which sat in his account, waiting for the time to come when Pollock would realize building his mushroom super lab. This was all raised by Pollock just from writing prescriptions to his patients, who might be more aptly classified as customers. A busy day writing prescriptions at his office would net Pollock upwards of $10,000 for a single day's work. With his practice rapidly expanding, Pollock had hundreds of patients who wanted to be seen by him each week. Pollock provided discreet surgeries that were performed right there in his kitchen, with the surgeries including the removing of bullets from the gunshot wounds of patients who, because of the criminal activities they were often engaged in, which would have resulted in them getting shot, wanted to seek out the service offered by Pollock, who was now a criminal himself. They preferred his discreet service rather than the alternative, where they would go to the hospital and possibly suffer the legal consequences. According to Pollock's girlfriend at the time, Mitzi, there was one occasion where Pollock wrote a prescription for opioids to a patient that was carried into Pollock's office by several men, while she lay there completely unconscious. Though aside from the majority of Pollock's medical practices, which were universally frowned upon, and certainly in violation of the Hippocratic Oath sworn by all physicians, Pollock also provided medical care to low-income families and their children, completely free of charge. Pollock's lawyer, Peter Suska, advised his client to purchase an examination table and medical scale for his office, so that the office seemed more legitimate and like one that a law-abiding doctor would own. On the evening of January 31st, 1981, Pollock took the advice of his lawyer and finally got around to purchasing an examination table for his office. While Pollock eagerly awaited the outcome of the investigation that looked into him and his business practices that was conducted by the Texas Medical Board, law enforcement in San Antonio were also performing an investigation into Pollock, and they had already been looking into Pollock's medical records. While combing through Pollock's records, authorities discovered 10,000 Quaaludes which had been issued to his single pharmacy by Pollock. That weekend, a hearing was scheduled for the following Monday. The hearing was called after two members of the San Antonio police force went undercover posing as patients when Pollock prescribed them a script for dexedrine, the amphetamine medication requiring a doctor's prescription for the drug, much to the displeasure of speed freaks. At the same time, the DEA were also investigating Pollock, surveilling his properties, including land that Pollock owned that was located near Twin Sisters in San Antonio. Flying planes over top, they discovered several acres of cannabis that Pollock was growing on the property with the intention of selling it to raise funds for his lab. Soon, a grand jury indicted Pollock for his illicit cannabis growing operation. As Pollock's actions and behavior as a physician grew, his secretary refused to come into work, requiring Pollock to hire a new secretary named Patty Halperin. On the evening of February 1st, 1981, Pollock was staying late working in his office, despite it being a Saturday. Pollock had been working so much in order to fill out prescriptions and fundraise his plans for a lab, the doctor was working 7 days a week straight and seeing around 30 patients each day. Pollock would work all day with appointments starting at noon and ending around 6 p.m., when the amount of patients coming in started slowing down for the day. Pollock's new secretary, who had only just started working there the preceding Wednesday, Patty Halperin, began her task of preparing Pollock's lunch, which consisted of a bowl of chicken soup that day, around 1 p.m. when she came into the office. While Halperin was aware of Pollock's criminal acts as a doctor, the new secretary chose to look the other way, despite still feeling uneasy about the doctor's illegal medical practices. On that day, neither Pollock's patients nor his secretary, Ms. Halperin, reported that there was anything that seemed unusual that day, with the workaholic Pollock often working until late into the evening, as he did most days. Once 4 p.m. came around, Pollock phoned his girlfriend, Mitzi. An hour later, at 5, she went to Pollock's office in order to deliver his dinner, bringing 2 Cornish hens for them to enjoy. At 6, Pollock saw his last patient, with his secretary having left the office for the day to go home. Once she returned home, citing the grievances with her job as Pollock's secretary, including non-stop phone calls, as well as patients with difficult personalities, Halprin confided in her boyfriend that she had no plans to return to work, after having worked for Pollock for less than a week. Back at the office, Pollock, now all alone in the location that served as both his place of work and his home on Spring Brook, answered a phone call from his girlfriend, who wanted to check in and see if he planned to be able to make their dinner date at 7 that evening. Pollock told Mitzi that he had just one more patient to see and he would be able to meet her for dinner after they left. At the close of their conversation, Mitzi told Pollock that she loved him and said that she wanted to get married, although Pollock did not want to get married until after a prenuptial agreement was signed by Mitzi. At 9:30 that night, Paul Stamets called Pollock, excited to share a reference for Psilocybe tamponensis, which he knew that Pollock was still trying to get a patent for. Stamets thought the information would be useful to Pollock, and he wanted to tell his friend what he'd just found. Although the last time the two spoke together, they did not leave on good terms, with the two not speaking to each other for several months until that conversation that night. Their conversation was interrupted as Pollock excused himself to go answer a knock at his front door, telling Stamets that he would call back. This came at the great annoyance of Stamets, who at the time was still a student, short on finances, having to pay the fees required for him to make a long-distance phone call from Evergreen State College in Washington over to Texas, where Pollock was. When Stamets tried calling Pollock back, he saw the line was busy. He tried a third time to phone the doctor, when Pollock finally picked up and allowed Stamets to recite the article on tamponensis he had found. But before he could finish, Pollock interrupted Stamets once again, while he ran to go get a pencil to take notes with. When Pollock came back, he had to interrupt their call yet again, telling Stamets some patients had just pulled up in his driveway, but telling his friend that he would call back as soon as they left. Stamets vocally expressed his anger with Pollock at the frequent interruptions on his end. Mitzi then attempted to call Pollock, but the phone just rang 4 times before it went to Pollock's answering machine. She then got into her car and drove to Pollock's office, bringing with her the 2 Cornish hens the couple planned on eating for dinner that night. When Mitzi arrived, she noticed that the door to Pollock's office was locked, with the deadbolt firmly in place. This was highly unusual, as Pollock normally would always keep his door unlocked. After several attempts to ring Pollock's doorbell and receiving no response, Mitzi climbed Pollock's fence in order to get into his backyard. Once inside, she saw that Pollock was lying on the floor unconscious, though Mitzi believed that he had merely knocked himself out while trying to light the pilot to his furnace, as it was now winter and the weather outside was starting to get cool. Pollock had knocked himself unconscious trying to light the furnace on one instance before. Soon, Mitzi ran down Pollock Street, looking for a neighbor to help in the houses down Springbrook Avenue, hoping to find someone that was home. Mitzi then saw the home belonging to the Lowman family, with its lights on inside. When Mitzi knocked on the door, the homeowner, a Mr. Emery Lowland, answered, while his 15-year-old son, Christopher, stood at his side. Encountering a likely hysterical Mitzi, Lowland threatened to call the police, though Mitzi begged them not to, as she feared that involving the police would cause a lot of problems for Pollock, and a visit to his home would likely end in his arrest. Deciding not to phone the cops, Emery and his teenage son followed Mitzi over to Pollock's house, where she and the 15-year-old Christopher were able to climb the fence. They shined flashlights into Pollock's window, with the light passing through the reinforced steel bars that served as protection for the place that was Pollock's home, office, and laboratory combined. Now finally able to see inside through Pollock's back patio door, Mitzi made a grisly discovery. She saw that blood had been spattered on the walls of Pollock's living room as she came to the realization that her lover, the eccentric mushroom doctor Steven Hayden Pollock, had been murdered. Pollock's cause of death was a single bullet from the barrel of a .357 Magnum administered straight to his head. At the scene of the crime, Pollock's body was on the floor at the corner near his front door. The clothes he was wearing were covered in blood. There was a 1-inch laceration on his face and a cut in his jeans, with his pockets turned inside out, with its only contents remaining being Pollock's keys, which sat beside his lifeless body. Pollock's right arm was bent back, while his other arm sat flush against his side, with several brown hairs which did not belong to Pollock around where his fingers were. Visible in Pollock's office was a set of 12 ornamental glass mushrooms that were placed on the chest located near Pollock's door. Pollock's house had been ransacked, with his mattress thrown off its bed frame while his pillows lay beside it, completely gutted, with a mess of its flurry white stuffing covering Pollock's bedroom. Pollock's furnace door was open, as were his closets, with all of his clothes and belongings scattered all over the room. Elsewhere in the house, Pollock's chairs had been flipped over, the cord of his telephone line had been cut, and his freezer door sat open, displaying the bags of frozen blueberries that sat inside, which were now melting into a pool of water. With the police now investigating what has become a crime scene, Paul Stamets attempted to phone Pollock's office once again, only this time the receiver was picked up by a police officer, which Stamets describes as Pollock's killer. Pollock's funeral service was held the following Tuesday, on February 3rd, at Christ of the Hills Monastery, run by Russian Orthodox priests, led by local Texas television figure Sam Green. Dropping his previous history as a drag queen, known as Groovy Granny Green, alongside his business ventures and attempts to promote land near San Antonio's neglected South Side, Green changed his name before declaring himself a Russian Orthodox priest, and then forming an organization known as the Ecumenical Monks Incorporated. At Pollock's funeral, Green, now Father Bishop, read his sermon, clad in a black kamilavka and matching veil, with the father in stark contrast to the all-white outfits worn by mourners during Pollock's service. In his casket, one of Pollock's hands grasped Pollock's Matthias Romero cubensis, and the other, another strain of Psilocybe cubensis, developed by Pollock named Renaissance, named after the Houston area Texas Renaissance Festival, where it was found. In Pollock's jacket, his prized cosmic commote lay in his breast pocket, lovingly placed there by Pollock's Hidden Creek business partner, Michael Forbes. At the service, Pollock's friends and family were given Tampinensis clarotia to eat in honor of Pollock, who adored the fungi. The music at Pollock's funeral was performed by a local group of honky-tonk musicians known as the Supernatural Family Band. The band's pedal steel player, Connie Hancock, has described a memory of looking outside the window while on stage, where he saw the serene monastery grounds littered with wild peacocks as the ground was covered in a light layer of snow, an incredibly rare occurrence in the area. While searching Pollock's home office and lab, San Antonio police discovered 1,753 quart-sized glass mason jars, which were all growing psilocybin mushrooms, in an operation that authorities claim is the single largest mushroom bust in United States history, even to this day. Other discoveries made by police include items such as Pollock's collection of jars that were filled with purple honey, a large number of agar slants, and several spore prints of psilocybin-containing mushroom species, as well as a collection of manure belonging to an assortment of wild animals, with each collection of feces meticulously labeled by Pollock, and various laboratory equipment and supplies necessary for growing and examining the psychoactive mushrooms that Pollock spent his entire adult life researching. Upon hearing news of his son's death, Stephen Pollock's father, Walter Pollock, soon flew in from L.A. Though their relationship was estranged while Pollock was still alive, and Pollock's father had been largely unaware of his son's scientific investigations into mushrooms, he felt that it was important to try to save his son's work upon discovery of Pollock's research, and he made an attempt to preserve some of the rare psilocybin species, many of which were still unknown to science, urging the authorities to hold off destroying the mushrooms, arguing that there were likely medical discoveries contained within the fungi which would prove invaluable to science. Though Pollock's father was able to get a court order and take up residence in Pollock's home on Springbrook Avenue, he soon called Stephen's former lawyer, Peter Suska, informing him that a DEA SWAT team had arrived at Pollock's home office and had an order granting them power to search the home and seize its contents. Walter also met with Michael Forbes, who helped run his son's Hidden Creek mushroom business, as he was intent on keeping his son's company operational, advising Forbes to move Hidden Creek operations to Haiti, with the elder Pollock stating that he had Haitian criminal connections who could help protect the business there, though Forbes declined Walter's offer. Before flying back home to California, Walter Pollock took what little of the collection of specimens of his son's rare mushroom species that he could. Unfortunately, the vast majority of Pollock's mushrooms were seized by the San Antonio Narcotics Force and were incinerated at the city dump. though before this occurred, some of Pollock's spores were sent to his associates, including the spores of his penis envy strain being sent to Rich G. Meanwhile, Pollock's murder was still unsolved, with the murderer still somewhere out there at large, although investigators had no real leads in the case. There was a rumor among Pollock's friends and associates that involved a grand conspiracy involving a police cover-up, with the cops hiding a key piece of evidence with a supposed CCTV videotape of Pollock being murdered. Walter Pollock offered a $500,000 reward for any information that would lead to the arrest of his son's murderers. An obituary for Pollock appeared in High Times. The magazine's obituarist, Mike Fellner, claimed to have heard inklings in his discussions with detectives involved with the investigation that indicated that law enforcement did not hold solving Pollock's murder to be a top priority. And he heard discussions that authorities were even pleased that Pollock was now murdered, eradicating the problem that they tried so hard to stop during Pollock's life. There were, however, some clues that couldn't be ignored, like the bloody towel in Pollock's bathroom and a mysterious bullet hole found in Pollock's garage door. Investigators went through Pollock's records, looking at the doctor's patients. Two phone calls were discovered from unidentified women that occurred on the very same night that Pollock was murdered. Pollock's records had been rifled through by the perpetrators who committed Pollock's murder, with evidence of clear attempts to hide or emphasize certain patient data. Just minutes before Pollock's murder occurred, an unknown woman made a call to the medical examiner's office, asking the examiner if the body of a doctor had been brought into the morgue recently, stating that she heard a doctor had been involved with a disturbance with an attorney. Another mysterious phone call arousing suspicion was made at 2:04 a.m., while detectives were still going over the crime scene at Pollock's residence. It was made by a woman who supplied a fake name and probed detectives with questions regarding Pollock's whereabouts. One suspect that was discovered in Pollock's case was a local pimp in San Antonio named Archie Lee Johnson. Pollock's neighbors observed Johnson cruising in his Cadillac Eldorado along Springbrook Avenue, where Pollock's residence was located. The motive behind Johnson murdering Pollock was thought to have been over an argument that the two men had over a $50,000 debt that the doctor owed to Johnson. There was even a conspiracy theory that implicated Texas billionaire Ross Perot, the independent populist in the 1992 presidential election against Democratic candidate Bill Clinton and Republican incumbent George H.W. Bush, who had previously been director of the CIA before serving his role as vice president during Ronald Reagan's 8-year administration. Another theory involved a former business partner of Pollock's, a chemist named Tom Van Duzer, who had a gripe against Pollock over a recipe for liquid inoculum, which Van Duzer believed Pollock to have stolen. Once Pollock and Van Duzer's relationship turned sour, the two became bitter rivals, with Van Duzer's company being driven to bankruptcy when the mushroom kits being sold by the company suffered a deathly blow that came in the way of a defect in the inoculation ports of the kits. The ports became clogged with brown rice, putting an end to his mushroom kit business ventures for good. On the night of Pollock's murder, his girlfriend annoyed the detectives working at Pollock's crime scene, repeatedly asking to be allowed to enter the crime scene in order to fetch her kitchen utensils. Mitzi believes that it was the San Antonio police themselves who, in their desire to enact revenge on the drug-peddling mushroom doctor, murdered him that night in his Springbrook home. Mitzi also made it a point to mention a mysterious local woman, which she referred to as the Black Widow. Numerous other conspiracies, often wild and outlandish, persisted among Pollock's friends and associates. The theory that had the greatest implications alleged that the United States government themselves had orchestrated Pollock's murder, hoping to put an end to his drug dealing for good. Certainly, many government agencies were watching Pollock, including the DEA, who moved in to destroy the several hundred acres of cannabis crops that Pollock was growing on a ranch, which they discovered previously while surveilling Pollock. Michael Forbes mentioned a plan which he states Pollock concocted just 3 days before his murder. Pollock told Forbes that he paid Archie Lee Johnson, the San Antonio pimp that Pollock owed money to, $5,000 to have two police officers that were to testify against Pollock killed. These undercover officers had received prescriptions from Pollock and were scheduled to testify against him in the medical board hearing, which was to occur the following week. Pollock discovered the identities of the undercover cops, whose names were listed in a criminal complaint made against the doctor, and orchestrated a hit against them, enlisting the help of Archie Lee Johnson as his hitman. Johnson had already been known for trying to murder a police officer years earlier. In a turn of events, Johnson tried to place the hit back around on Pollock himself, The unidentified women responsible for the mysterious phone calls on the night of Pollock's murder were two of Johnson's girls, who were calling in order to verify that the hit on Pollock was successful. Today, Michael Forbes still believes that whoever Pollock's murderer was, they were acting on behalf of the police, who he points as being responsible for orchestrating the hit against Pollock. Gary Davis uncovered a mysterious cassette tape in which two men sitting in a diner discussed the recent murder of Pollock, perhaps leaving some more clues as to his murder. Davis had known Pollock after first approaching the doctor, who is the resident authority on all things related to psilocybin in Texas. While he was finishing his master's in clinical psychology, Davis got a job studying ESP at the Mind Science Foundation in San Antonio. In 1977, while working with the psychologist Harvey Ginsberg, who was conducting research where he sought to evaluate THC's potential for reducing aggression in the Mongolian gerbil, Davis had the idea of administering psilocybin to the gerbils in order to see if the compound was effective in reducing the animal's aggressive behavior. Seeking Pollock's expertise, Davis asked the doctor which salt of psilocybin would be best equipped for injecting into the rodents for the experiment. Although Davis's idea for an experiment testing the effects of psilocybin on rodents never did end up getting off the ground, Davis and Pollock kept in touch, and the two became close acquaintances. In 1980, while Davis became an abnormal psychology lecturer at Texas State in San Marcos and was living in an apartment with a roommate known simply as Bob, who was the owner of a liquor store in San Antonio, Davis's roommate Bob came into the possession of a mysterious cassette tape that is said to contain evidence surrounding Pollock's murder. The cassette was found in a cassette player that Bob had obtained from a drifter who came into Bob's shop asking to trade his tape recorder for a bottle of wine. Bringing the tape home, he played the cassette in front of Gary Davis, who had no idea that such a recording even existed. The audio on the tape features a conversation where two men discuss shooting a man that they refer to as the Mushroom Doctor. Davis, believing this to be a key piece of evidence that might solve Pollock's murder, incessantly analyzed the tape's audio, concluding that there is no clear admission of guilt from either of the men during the conversation. Davis asked that Bob question the drifter that sold him the tape and player in order to ascertain where he would have gotten the tape from. The next time the drifter appeared in Bob's store, he admitted that he stole the tape from the seat of an unmarked police car that was parked in front of the Metro Squad's headquarters. Upon discovering this information, David and Bob, fearing that the person behind Pollock's murder might come after whoever possessed the tape, chose to remain silent about its existence. Michael Forbes was also wary about discussing any information regarding Pollock's unsolved murder, fearing repercussions from whoever was behind the murder. Davis hung on to the tape, storing it at his mother's house for 3 decades, before being uncovered once again in 2011, when Davis gave the cassette to Hamilton Morris, a writer and filmmaker that covers subjects relating to the area of psychedelics. On March 5, 1983, following up on a tip by a confidential informant, Detective Anton Michalek interviewed a man named Virgil Lissy, who had reported that two of his friends had been heard bragging about killing Pollock. Eventually, investigators were able to get a confession out of Lissy. In 1981, Lissy lived with two other roommates, with the three men sharing the fact that they had all been former patients of Pollock's, frequently receiving their fill of narcotics from the doctor. Lissy, a former fireman that had been fired after a methamphetamine conviction, was the leader of a group manufacturing meth, comprising of Lissy and his two roommates, with Lissy serving as the group's cook. The night that Pollock was murdered, Lissy was away in Austin, although he returned to San Antonio the following day, as he had a doctor's appointment with Pollock, who was going to write Lissy a prescription for Quaaludes. That day, on February 2nd of 1981, he first heard news of Pollock's death, with local newspapers like the San Antonio Express News reporting on his death, along with Pollock's associates, who appeared on San Antonio's public access television to memorialize him. At the end of February that year, Lissy's roommates bragged to Lissy that they were responsible for shooting Pollock, cutting open the doctor's Pollock's and getting into a struggle with him before ending the doctor's life with a single bullet to the head. Lissy's roommate, Baker, revealed that he was the individual responsible for pulling the trigger and shooting Pollock in the head. Lissy revealed the information he'd just discovered to Detective Michalek, although he was worried that his roommates might try to kill him if they discovered that Lissy was a police informant. Investigating the fingerprints found at the crime scene at the time of Pollock's murder, Detective Michalek found that they were a match for Baker and Deitzman, Lissy's roommates. Baker's ring finger left a print on the inside of Pollock's front door. Another fingerprint was found on the receiver of Pollock's office phone. Yet another fingerprint was found to belong to Lissy's cousin and former roommate, Arthur Lenz, a meth dealer. When brought in for questioning, Lenz eventually admitted to having been at Pollock's office with a female friend on the day of Pollock's murder, but cannot remember the time he visited his office, nor the name of the friend who accompanied him. Baker, upon finding out that Lissy was speaking to police, attempted to flee town, but was soon pulled over and apprehended by cops. Lenz failed the polygraph test given to him while in custody, while a long list of evidence piled up which framed the trio as being the individuals responsible for murdering Pollock, including the fact that Pollock's stolen credit card was found on a street between Pollock's Springbrook office and the group's Green Oak apartment, as well as the fact that none of the men had an alibi for the night of the murder. Michalek presented the case to District Attorney of Bayard County, Terry McDonald, although McDonald refused the case for reasons that are not entirely known. Michalek's investigation hit a dead end, and with no new leads, the Pollock case sat untouched for decades. When former DA Terry McDonald was asked by Hamilton Morris why he didn't prosecute despite all the evidence that surrounded the case, McDonald revealed that he wasn't actually the district attorney during the years that the Pollock investigation took place. When Morris filed an open records request with Bayard County's DA office in order to find out who was the DA during those years, he was surprised to discover that there was no file that existed on Pollock at all, with the DEA explaining that they had destroyed at least four documents related to the Pollock investigation. Steven L. Peel, a former police officer turned mushroom researcher, began to grow and research psilocybin mushrooms after receiving a Schedule 1 permit from the DEA. In 1984, 3 years after Pollock's death, Peel began publishing his research into Psilocybe tampanensis for the Journal of Mushroom Cultivation, where Peel was editor-in-chief. Peel began selling cultures of Psilocybe tampanensis for $510 each, a species so rare that at the time it was appraised to be worth $45,000 elsewhere. Calling it the rarest mushroom species in the world, Peel lamented the fact that tampanensis was seemingly lost, remarking that even Paul Stamets has lost his culture. At the end of the 80s, Peel decided to attempt to reintroduce the species, which was then nearly extinct, growing the mushroom on giant outdoor plots of manure inoculated with Psilocybe tampanensis spawn, with Peel hoping that the spores of tampanensis would get carried by north winds, although the species had still remained undiscovered in the wild. At the end of the decade, with Peel's DEA license soon to expire, Peel sent a live tampanensis culture to the European Fungus Library. Peel had been growing massive outdoor beds of the mushroom as he attempted to isolate various characteristics into 914 separate strains, which would be best suited for outdoor growth. On June 4, 1995, during the height of the hurricane season, Peel brought bales of Psilocybe tampanensis specimens during Hurricane Opal when a strong wind came and blew Peel's mushrooms over, carrying billions of tampanensis spores and sending them into the air. In mid-June of 1995, Gaston Guzman succeeded in collecting a wild specimen of Psilocybe tampanensis, which he discovered in a Mississippi meadow. The species had only been found in the wild once before, when Pollock originally discovered the species in the late 70s. During a trip to the Netherlands, Gary Davis was astonished to find that Pollock's Psilocybe tampanensis camote was sold in head shops across the country, a species which Davis thought to have been extinct, perishing along with Pollock. The Dutch were growing the tampanensis sclerotia on an industrial scale, utilizing a large laboratory with 15 temperature-controlled growth chambers, each capable of accommodating 610-pound bags of ryegrass media, a walk-in autoclave the size of a bank vault, and a double airlocked clean room where tanks of liquid mycelial cultures were maintained by technicians dressed in surgical scrubs. The scale of the Dutch laboratory was something that Pollock dreamed of accomplishing during his lifetime, making it his life's goal to procure funding for his giant state-of-the-art mushroom lab. The sclerotia were packaged and sent to smart shops in Amsterdam, where they were marketed as psychedelic truffles, with the species that Pollock held with such reverence being spread to eager consumers and tourists looking for a legal means of expanding their consciousness. At the turn of the century, Psilocybe fanaticus had gotten a hold of Pollock's penis-shaped mushroom strain and began to cultivate it, implementing UV light growth experimentation. Penis Envy would receive its name when marketed as such by the popular spore distributor and sponsor of Shroomery.org, SporeWorks, who not only sell both varieties of Penis Envy, but also Pollock's Psilocybe tampanensis. Pollock's legacy extends beyond the species he discovered. He was one of psilocybin's most ardent and vocal supporters, who believed that it could heal not only psychological problems, but also physiological ailments as well. Dr. Pollock was ahead of his time in regard to his vision of FDA-approved psilocybin studies as well, which in recent years, thanks to groups like MAPS, have been rapidly advancing by institutions like Johns Hopkins University.